They say that these days the people can tell within 10 seconds what the video's about and whether they're going to watch it or not. But I have no idea what I'm going to say. It could go any one of 360 degrees, absolutely spontaneously, right? So here you have to watch more than 10 seconds. It's blazing hot again today, 101 degrees, and it's still really hot out here, but I've got this long sleeve jacket on. I don't want the mosquitoes to be chomping on me like they are, like they have been apparently. And it's a heat wave here. Really, the records are smashed in the Bay Area yesterday. All-time records for the state. They were really smashed by like 3 degrees, 4 degrees, sometimes 7 degrees. I was like, wow. As someone from Gilroy, I talked to him. He says, my house was 112. And the other ones said from somewhere a little north of there, he says, 100 was, I had 109 at my house. So he went south. It got hotter. Really got hotter and hotter and hotter. Was talking to a man today, and he said, that'll be $18.63. I was buying something. $18.63. I said, "Hey, wait! Wasn't 1863? Wasn't it in the Civil War then? That's the Civil War time, right? 1863." And he goes, "Ah, I think it was 1865." He said. I said, "Yeah, maybe." He said, "But I'm not sure. You know, it could have been 1863." But he says, "For sure, it was really close to this in the Civil War. It was very, very close to the Civil War." He says, "Maybe it's like a year and a half away or something." I said, "Interesting statement." And then I said, I'll look it up. And I go home. I looked it up. 1863 is right in the middle of a civil war. Right in the middle of a civil war. Started 1861, went to 1865. So I was right. It was right in the Civil War, 1863. But he was interested in what I had to say. He was a different type of person. You can notice some people, they're bright somehow, and they're willing to pay attention. And others, they're on autopilot. You know, he wasn't on autopilot. This guy, he was not on autopilot. So occasionally you run into those who are not on autopilot, and he picked up on what I said. He just didn't go past him, and he said, "Huh, yeah." So that's really interesting. I didn't say anything else. Maybe I won't hear either. I won't drop the other shoe. I'm driving along the freeway. There's a shoe on the road. Or was it the freeway or something? No, it wasn't the freeway. It was off the freeway. There's a shoe in the road. And I said, you know, there's the other shoe. Or what am I going to meet next? Who am I going to meet next? Bodhidharma? You know, this man was on the road, and he met this guy with one shoe. This amazing man with one, he was carrying one shoe. And he was on his way to China, and this man was walking away from China somehow. And when he got to China, there was this big furor about Bodhidharma, whether he was really in the grave at all. So they dug up his grave, and he wasn't there, except there was one shoe in the grave, and it was the same shoe as the one shoe of the man he met on the road. Yeah. So I saw that shoe. I said, who am I going to meet next? Bodhidharma? Where's the other shoe? Bodhidharma, that's a nice name. Who are we going to meet next? That's the question, isn't it? So a lot of practice today in the new way practice, continually bringing it up, and it's only taken what 48 years of intense effort to get to this point on my part, where when Tom Carpenter in Dialogue on Awakening asks Jesus, he keeps beaking Jesus, you know, like, hey, you know, question, 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 come on, and he keeps asking the questions from same questions from a different angle and repackages it and this and that, and Jesus is very consistent. He said, look, it'd be better for you instead of how do I fix this problem, he says, change your mind about how you see the problem, change your mind about the problem. He said, the only way to deal with the problem, the only approach is to change your mind about the problem. So Tom might be saying, well, how do I fix the world and all its problems? He says, Jesus would say, you know, say, change your mind about it. And I would say, practice saying There is no world. I can never have any world. I can never be in any world at all. I can never be in any world. So what Jesus is suggesting is to change, really change your expectations of what it is you're experiencing. He says you're experiencing a problem because you believe it's possible. But just tell it's, you expect that it's going to be there. You expect it's possible, because what we're really doing is believing in the possibility of changing reality, and that entails expectations. So he says, work within the field of expectations, because it's too difficult to drop them all at once. But change your expectations. Change the expectations. Like, I can't even have any health. I can't have any health at all. Now we might be thinking, well, I want good health. Well, that's dualistic, because good health implies also you could have bad health, and you're avoiding the bad health by having the good health. But Jesus would say, change your mind about the problem and say, I can't have any health at all. I can't have any health at all. So I'm very simpatico with this approach. Like I said, it's only taken me 48 years of hitting my head against the wall, because it does seem like a very radical solution to it, is change your mind about the problem. Don't try to fix it or solve it. Tell yourself, that basically say, I can't have problems. I can never have any problems at all. It's impossible for me to have even the slightest problem. Say that. Practice saying that. It's absolutely impossible for me to have any problem whatsoever. This is called reshaping expectations. It's not enough to just hear Jesus saying, change your mind about your problem, and saying, try saying like what, or try, think about it like this, I can't have any problems. Well, if you just hear that and put it into an accumulation of knowledge, like a fact or some knowledge, something that the teacher said for you to regurgitate on some test. When you think, when the test is later, you say, okay, Jesus will say, okay, how should you deal with problems? You say, huh, I can't really think. Oh yeah, Jesus said, change your mind about the problem. That's option C. I'll check C. I hope I get an A on the test then now. Okay, so too many of us have been schooled in the academic system of this world, which I always say this is the major problem, one of the most hideous problems you have, is you've been trained like a monkey to do a dance and get a banana or something, that to you need to get grades to be in school to be happy. Now I gave up trying to go after grades when I was 12 years old. I said, I'm done. And I just faked it the rest of the way, and ultimately couldn't keep up, couldn't keep up, because I never paid any attention to anything that the teacher said after that. Really, I was done. I remember I did pay attention to the journalism class, media and journalism class, because the emphasis was on being a media watchdog, and seeing the way the media manipulated the news, depending on who the power sources they were serving. I paid attention to that because that's always been one of my interests. But by and large, no, I did not pay any more attention. I didn't care. And really, like I said, like in chemistry, geometry, algebra 2, physics, all this stuff, I literally didn't even take the tests. I would just, like, I get like a chemistry test, and there's a multiple choice, like A, B, C, D. And I would just check A on every single one. I get the test, I check A, and then I turn in my test in like about 2 minutes, and then I go to sleep. And physics, I don't even know. I don't even think I even took that. I just turned a blank and got an F on. I just turned in a blank test. I didn't even take the test. And nobody, the teachers never said anything to me. I just wasn't interested anymore, you see. Takes a lot of guts to do that when you're young, right? And everybody's frantically fighting for A's and scholarships and everything, to just turn it a blank test. Turn it a blank test. F. But it was an accelerated program, so the worst they could give me was a C minus. I didn't even know that. I didn't care. I didn't care about grades anymore, because I knew that this would sink me, if I kept trying to get grades, because that's book learning. That's not taking advice to heart, so that you really work on your expectations. You have to actually reshape your expectations, which is a great labor, actually. The spiritual path is a great labor. Okay, it's not remembering what the teacher told you. So when you get a test, you get an A on a test. Okay, that's absolutely has nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. So it seems like the more people excel in academia, the more blocked they are, you know, towards the spiritual path, because they keep trying to turn it into some sort of test that they're going to take at some point. So they say, just give me the answers to the test, and I'm fine, because I'm really good at remembering answers to tests, right? This is a plague. The really, people talk about the black plague, right? In the medieval times, it kind of ended the medieval ages, and the Renaissance came after that, because, you know, people said, wow. A much worse plague than the Black Plague really is the plague of modern education. Okay, it is really a terrible, terrible plague. And it's really sunk the ship of Dharma in the world. We don't realize we have to really labor for it. Honest labor, where you actually practice, you actually feel the burn, the shock, you have to block the panic. You're right there in the front line in the trenches. You're not saying, okay, so this is the answer, great, I can remember that when the test comes, I'll write that down, I'll get an A on the test, and I'm done. I got my diploma. There's no diploma here to get. There's no diploma to get. Don't focus on results. Focus on the labor, the practice of reshaping your expectations. This is the only way. Nobody's ever done it by just memorizing and then regurgitating on some test. Like the master says, okay, disciples, what's the answer? Disciples, someone says, yeah, I got it. What's that? Well, you told us about a couple years ago that this is the answer. Master says, okay, but what else did I tell you? I don't really remember. I told you, you have to be practicing this. Have you been practicing it? And I didn't get that part. You sure you said that? Maybe you didn't say that. I got a good memory. I don't think you said that. trying to confuse the master, right? Master said, yes, of course I said it. That's all. I saw. I repeated it thousands of times. Have you been practicing it? No, I kind of skipped over that part because I already knew the answer, which was, you gave us that. I said, the answer is to practice, is to use this form of reshaping your expectations in such a way like this. You know, there is no world to fix. How do we fix the world? There is no world to fix. I can never, ever be in any world at all. There's no world to fix. There's no world to fix. So change your mind about the problem. When someone asks Jesus, well, how do I fix the problems of the world? Jesus says, there is no world to fix. There are no problems. You can never have any problems. I say, I can never have any problems. When he says, say that, it means say it every day. Say it every day, maybe for the rest of your life, or until you awaken. And even then, it bears repeating over and over, setting a good example to others. So the Dharma is a lifelong labor where you actually reshape your expectations. Literally say, I can't have any problems. I'll never have even the slightest problem. Instead of saying, Jesus, how do I fix this problem? Jesus advises us to say, I can never have even the slightest problem. It's completely impossible for me to have even the slightest problem. And by saying this and on this type of practice, he says, you will awaken from the dream and realize it's true, that you're only dreaming that you could have problems, but you really can't have any problems at all. You're only dreaming of a world that could have problems, but there really isn't any such world that can have problems at all. It doesn't exist in reality at all. It's not possible. It's not possible. Because every moment is totally fresh and clean and clear of every other moment. It's only the now, the eternal now. And whatever you want, you have it. So how could anything be sick? Everything is 100% exactly as you want it. And if you don't want that, you're completely free to choose something else. So you can never state that I have a problem. That's impossible for us to have a problem. To say that we have a problem is directly stating that we believe that we've changed reality. It's directly stating that, actually. So what we do is the opposite, directly state that we haven't changed reality. And we can't. I can never have a problem. I've never had a problem. I never will have a problem. I can never have even the tiniest problem. So it's this type of practicing, which I certainly believe is what awakens us. And now we might be saying, well, how come I'm not awake? I've been working for 48 years because I have, haven't been practicing this way enough, right? But so it's the same for all of us. We keep complaining, I'm not awake. Well, have we been practicing this way? Because this is what he says. He's very consistent. Says this is what you have to do to awaken from the dream. You cannot make the dream real and then fix the problems of this unreal dream. You say, yeah, the dream is real, and that I really do have problems. But Jesus, how do I fix those real problems? You see, that's the issue, isn't it? And he's very consistent. Says, no, 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 He's very consistent. Tom shot him all these questions from every angle, and Jesus said, no, 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 no. Listen, change your mind about the problem. That's all I can say to you, really. Now, thousands of years ago, in the future, it will always be the same. How do I awaken from the dream? You must awaken from the dream, and you must do it by saying, it's impossible for me to have any problems. So the whole dream is based on our belief we can have problems. So if we expect, our expectations are changed so that we expect to experience that we can't possibly have any problems in the first place, that will then enable our awakening to take place and sustain the awakening, because we won't panic. We won't panic. We'll say, oh, I expected this. Welcome home. I never left. It's like, how can I get back home? Jesus would say, change the way you view that problem. Say, I can never leave home. It's impossible for me to ever leave home. It's impossible for me to ever leave home. I can never leave home. I've never left home at all. It's completely impossible. So we must lay the groundwork in our expectations to awaken, so that when we awaken, the shock is such that we can wow it, and we can block the panic, because panic will certainly cause us to pivot back towards believing that we have problems. What we do is we say, great, I just saw divinity in its perfectness. So how do I use that to fix my problems? So this is what takes place, right? First you say, oh my God, everything's all perfect. This is, I got it. And then you start thinking, but what about the world's problems? The ecology, how do I fix that? And you think, well, how can I use this new divine energy, we call it energy, to apply to some problem? We think of it as an energy so that we think we can apply it to some problem, like as a force or something. It's not an energy or a force. It is. It's an essence. It just is. There's no problem to fix. So God is not some force that fixes problems at all. So as soon as we start looking at it in terms of energy, we're really back into belief that we have problems, that we need some force that will help us change something. There's nothing to change. I can never change anything. Reality is completely unchangeable. So there can never be any force or energy in reality that can change anything. It's just a formless idea and essence of mind experiencing. So when we panic, we then immediately say, oh great, I got it. So now I've got the juice to start working on these problems that have been bugging me for so long. And then you're right back in the dream. Right back in the dream. Now, you may have to hear, we may all have to hear this thousands and thousands of times, but what else is there to say? Now, I have heard it thousands and thousands and thousands of times, and gradually, it's like turning a big ocean liner around you. It takes a while, but gradually, I'm saying, this feels right. It feels right. It feels right. I expect this to be, the answer. I expect it. All the Dharma kings are in agreement that this is so, so obviously it's the answer, but it's so unexpected that I have to really work on changing my expectations. So we really have to apply whatever teachers tell us to our own expectations. It's not to the teacher's expectations on some test, like the teacher expects me to say this, so I'm meeting my teacher's expectations by saying this. That's not what it's about. It's about changing our expectations of what the answer is. Working on ourselves, not trying to please a teacher by regurgitating something that we think is working on their expectations. Like, oh, the teacher expects now that I'm a good student. Oh, great. No, I can never be a student. How can I be a student? I'm perfect. So there's another one. I can never be a student at all. Because I can never have any answers at all. I can never have any questions at all. How can I be a student? There are no answers and there are no questions. So how can I be a student? I can't. It's impossible for me to be a student. So you might be bemoaning the fact that, the education system, it's ruined me and this and this and that. But keep in mind, you could have done what I did, right? You said opted out, said forget it. This ruinous for me. Okay, or you could have really not cared that much about grades, that's possible. Or you could realize like, wow, that's not where it's at. But it's a nasty habit. It's a really nasty habit. I mean, our education really brings about some of the nastiest habits possible, actually. The most vicious habits possible. And that certainly is one of them, isn't it? Thinking that you're supposed to please the teacher instead of actually work on your own expectations. You want to please the teacher? Work on your own expectations. That's what Jesus said. What should we do? He said, follow my commandments to you. You know what to do, how to practice. Love your practicing. Really, he's saying, love your practicing. If you want to love your practicing and do it. If you come to me and say, Jesus, I know the answer, and Jesus says, well, did you practice? No, I know the answer you want. You gave me, so I'm just telling you what you told me. He said, but I told you to love your practicing. Have you done it? Have you done that? And if you haven't done it, he says, you're still dreaming. You still expect to use me, Jesus, to solve the world's problems, which are really just dream problems. You're just reinforcing the ego's game by believing that there are any such thing as real problems. So if you're ill, you have a problem, so it's impossible for me to have any problems. Like, instead of saying, well, how do I get more money, Jesus? Instead, Jesus would say, it's impossible for me to have any problems whatsoever. I literally can never have even the slightest problem. I'm incapable of ever experiencing the slightest problem, the slightest need. I'm incapable of ever experiencing even the slightest need. And of course, when I'm saying it, I mean accept it. When Ramana Maharshi would say, it's in the heart, what he means is you need to accept it in your core. In your core, meaning in your expectations. The heart of our expectations are really the heart of what keeps us dreaming, right? Our expectations. So we must take this all the way to our expectations and not just superficial verbal play, mental label play. Okay, that doesn't do anything. Take it into the heart, accept it into your expectations, and this will produce shock in you for sure. A kind of psychic shock. And then they have to block panic from that by expecting you're going to experience wow from what you're practicing. So you must expect the wow from your practicing, this shock. So, this is all it in a nutshell right here. And we always try to put it in a very simple, obvious way here. So you can hear it over and over and over. And literally, though, I mean, it's taken me so long to. You'll probably do it faster than I did because you have some more emphasis here. Whereas really, it was hard for me to find any emphasis at all on this. I couldn't find it. I just had to sort of pioneer it myself. I said, I've got to, keep working at it because I'm just not hearing what I want to hear. But right now, I'm hearing what I want to hear. But what I'm saying, this is what I've always wanted to hear. And so it's helpful if you hear anyone else like this. So instead of saying, I want abundance, say it's impossible for me to have any need whatsoever. It's totally impossible. I can never experience any need at all. He said that this better. He said, I recommend you do it that way instead of saying, well, I want a lot of money. I want a lot of abundance. I want to manifest this. And I say, it's impossible for me to ever have the slightest need whatsoever. I can never experience that need at all. It's impossible. And we might say, well, what am I doing? Well, I'm pretending to experience it. We can pretend, but it's not real need at all. It never will be. So what's the use of pretending then, It's not getting us anywhere. It's not getting us anywhere. Never has, never will. I can never get anywhere with my pretending. I can never get anywhere, period. Meaning, Right? How can I ever? I'm everywhere. How can I get anywhere? I can't get anywhere. I'm already everywhere. I can never get anywhere. Say that too. You can say that. I can never get anywhere. It's impossible for me to ever get anywhere. So truly, this is the new way, and Jesus really introduced that to us back in that dialogue on awakening, showing that he was adamant. He says, "You're not going to get anything else out of me. I'm this is what my reply is, and this is what my reply will continue to be. Change your mind about your problem. Say, I don't have a problem." He would ask, "Well, why do you think you need to have this problem?" But ultimately, it's because of our expectations, actually, and for no other reason. So just change your expectations. It's impossible for me to have a problem, which is literally true. So we change our expectations to reflect truth. We don't get rid of expectations. We change them to reflect truth, like a mirror. So we change, like a piece of granite, rocky granite, we polish it into a mirror. So now it's reflecting truth. All right? So reshape our expectations. It's the labor of love. If you love truth, if you love Jesus, if you love, then you will do the labor of love of reshaping your expectations. You have to love truth to do the labor. And I see so many people laboring. I'm around laborers all the time. And sometimes it's pretty scary, but for them, it's their life, it's what they love doing, and they feel that you got to do it, they have no choice. And their whole attitude is just, they don't complain. They don't complain. I'm looking at them saying, "Oh my, I saw my friend today, he was covered mud head to foot." And I said, "Man, you look like you've been in a war zone." And he kind of looks at me like, "Yeah, I kind of have been laboring so hard." I just said, "Wow, man, I just, I wouldn't want to do that. When I was younger, I would do that." You feel like, it's something that you can't avoid. You just so you have a different attitude towards it. So same thing. You have to love truth, and when you love truth, then the question, you don't ask yourself these questions: should I do this? Should I not do this? No, I love doing this. I love doing it. But yeah, it's difficult. I get tired. It's like laborers get tired. But they go home. They say, "I really did a lot of honest labor today, and I got a lot done, and I feel good about it." So you really have to be blue collar about it. Okay, you cannot be this entitlement, white collar entitlement attitude of like I'm smart. And so I can just remember what the teacher told me. That'll never get it done. You might say, "I can never be smart. It's actually impossible for me to be smart." What is there to be smart about, actually? Does reality need us to be smart about it? We have to learn something? I can never learn anything. I can never learn anything. I'm incapable of any learning. I'm incapable of ever being smart. So, part of our practice is certainly you can feel that it certainly touches all your academic expectations, which really form the core of your expectations, part of the really central core, don't they? I mean, there's very few people in the world that haven't been matriculated now through the modern educational system, especially in more affluent societies, right? It's like everybody has to go through it. It's like compulsory. Some go through homeschooling now. Which is can be helpful, right? Probably. It depends. It depends on the parents, etc., right? But it certainly it could be helpful. It all depends, right? But we have this our education is so important in this world. Everyone thinks it's like the most important thing in the world. A relative of mine just graduated from college last weekend, and it's just like super super important. If you have the money, you gotta send your kids to college, teach them how to sabotage themselves, which is all they're really doing. Earn a living. You might say, "There's no way I can earn a living. I can never earn a living. It's impossible to even have a living. I can never even have a living. I can't even have a life. It's impossible for me to have a life." Very, very true statement. How can a freedom have a life? How can eternal freedom in every moment be said to have a life? You can say it has an eternal life, but that's redundant, isn't it? Why even say it even has a life at all? It's just eternal. It's just eternal freedom. Never bound to any life. So it's better to say it can never be bound to any what we call life. It's impossible. It can never crystallize. Nothing ever crystallizes in reality at all. And nothing is outside of reality. So it means there's nothing really crystallized here at all. So change your mind about the problem is how Jesus teaches, how the Dharma Kings teach. Change your mind about the problem. It's either that or you keep on searching for answers, you know, keep on working in the chemistry lab. You know, how can I get well? Well, I'm not going to answer that. I'm going to say that it's impossible for me to ever even have any health at all, one way or the other. I can't possibly even have health at all. I can't have vulnerability in any way. So the issue of getting well, or how can I be safe, it would say, there's no way I can ever be safe. There's no way I can ever be safe because I can't be vulnerable in any way. I can never experience vulnerability in any way. So the issue of safety can't even arise. It cannot even arise for me. Now, it's true that this takes a lot of confidence, right, to say this. And that's one of the reasons that people don't do it. Is they're afraid they might lose their confidence. I think everybody can hear this. But what I experienced in my life, I lost my confidence, and I certainly did plummet like free fall all the way to the bottom. So I understand the hesitancy of everyone, because I say, man, this takes a lot of confidence to say this. What if I do this and then I end up losing my confidence? Then where am I at? You know, I don't have any expectations to go back to. I can't go back to my old expectations, you know? So, that is something that I've been looking at today. Because very few do this. Very few do this. And when I lost my confidence, it's been 48 years getting it back. Because I was this way when I came in the world. And I said, what are you talking about, sickness? You can't be sick. Nobody can be sick. And they said, well, you're such a rude, you know, arrogant idiot. What are you talking about? Look, this person's dying of cancer, and you say it's impossible for anybody sick? You're absolutely crazy. And when you're young, they wouldn't call you crazy. They're just saying you're very, very bad-mannered boy, you know, very inconsiderate boy, very selfish and inconsiderate. So I just got hammered, you know, when I was young. And eventually, then I lost confidence in truth. And when that happened, I had nothing to fall on, you know. I didn't have any expectations to fall on, hardly, except my previous lives. And so then I went back to those old patterns again, which were the very patterns, expectations I was trying to leave behind. So, and then I really didn't want those, so I just felt like, you know, in some sort of purgatory, you know, it was terrible. So, that's why very few do it. One of the reasons, I would say. One of the reasons. It's easy to do, but people say, yeah, but what if I lose my confidence along the way, and I decide, wow, you know, you get cold feet. So that's why I say you really need a dharmic culture. We know the answer. It's very simple. But again, that fear of losing your confidence and thinking you just fall into an abyss without really any other expectations. How do I function now that I believe I do have problems? You know, how do I fix all the world's problems? Oh my gosh. So my mind started just thinking constantly, said, oh my gosh, I don't know how to do it because I don't have those expectations anymore. Of how to function in a world with problems, etc. And so then I had to try and reconstitute those expectations, but I didn't really believe in them. So I was a mess. My mind was a mess. So I can practice this way now, because I get the context, and I'm not going to likely to backslide at this point. But when you come into this world, you know, born and come into this world, and you get hammered the way culture hammers you, you know, good luck holding on to this perspective, right? Holding on to truth here. I mean, it's just an insane asylum here. And the inmates are running this asylum. And so they say, welcome to our nice school. We're here to help you. And I'm saying, you're out here, but you're insane. You're trying to teach me insanity. He says, don't worry, we'll do a great job. I say, what if you don't do a great job? Well, they didn't. So they botched their job, you know. Anyway, so a dharmic culture where you have many who are stating what I'm stating here, practicing as Jesus tells us to practice. Now the Dharma King surprises to practice. The more you have of that, the less likelihood you're going to lose your confidence, because you have many people having your back. You have the culture has your back, and then you really can practice this way. I mean, we used to be so much more dharmic as a world. For instance, the Christian culture used to be so much more dharmic. They really would practice reshaping their expectations more towards truth. They really did. Anytime they were sick, they'd pray to God, said, you know, in their own way. They had a way of doing it, a style of doing it, and they really, to some extent, got after it. Not, they didn't quite have the context, clear context we have here, but they did the best they could with the context they had, and they truly believed that they did need to reshape, that they were, that they had something sinful within them, which is really your expectations, our expectations, then they had to reshape those towards truth and the gospel. They at least knew that that was necessary. They may not have known exactly clearly how to do it in many cases, but they certainly were trying. So, and the culture supported that. So if someone says dying of cancer, they would say, well, you know, they're dying of their sin. And if they repent of their sin, that the cancer is going to go away. Well, they're right. They're dying of their expectations that they can have cancer. So take away the expectation that you can even suffer at all, and the cancer is going to disappear. That's Christian science. Absolutely correct. This basic premise like that. And the America culture used to be heavily influenced by Christian science. It really was. And now it's like almost extinct in its form that was really effective form, you know. It's amazing. So when you wonder, well, why should we keep working and keep listening? Well, you're helping form dharmic culture by doing that, because in dharmic culture you have those who know how to practice, are willing to, because they're not afraid of losing their confidence, and then you have those who are trying to gather their resolve to practice and keep gathering it and keep gathering it. You have to keep gathering it as you go, because you don't want to lose your confidence. That is very true. So, but if you have this lunatic asylum that we have now as a world, quote unquote world, educational system, cultural, a socialization system, you could very well lose your confidence. I'm just being pragmatic, and this is how I honestly see it. There's very little support for this in the world at this point. That's what I expressed to Jesus today. I said, Jesus, this is honestly how I see it. You know, I'd lost my confidence here coming in the world, and do you really expect that everybody's just going to get with this? Like, oh yeah, it's easy. Well, it's easy to do, but it's also easy to lose your confidence if you don't. If you don't have enough support. Now, I just supported myself to such an extent, and I got support from the Dharma Kings. I was so determined, I was able to keep pushing, but you know, I really didn't thrive at it. Basically, I was like a dead person for most of my life. It was just, I loved truth so much, I wouldn't quit. But I didn't have the support, cultural support. I had to basically hide it from everyone. Nobody even knew I was doing it. That's the only way I could do it. Or else I would have gotten crushed. I would have gotten crushed. This notion that somehow, no, just tell everybody what you're doing. Oh, isn't that wonderful? That's absolutely not true at all. That surface, they'll say that because they want to appear as a good person. But then they go to work sabotaging it because it shocks their expectations severely, and they don't know how to deal with that at all. So they'll say, you need to change what you're saying. So it meets my expectations. So it's really a non-dharmic culture. It really is. Whereas in the past, if somebody, you know, said, "Okay, cancer, we pray for you. The sin is gone. You're absolved of all sin." You know, they had their way of doing that. It was a psychological thing, and the person realize that they truly were saved of sin, and they're free of sin, the cancer would disappear. They'd be healed, and then people, you'd tell people about that, and they'd say, and you know what they'd say? They'd say, "Praise God! Thank you for telling me. Praise God! Praise God!" And they would take that to heart. You know, a lot of them. They wouldn't say, "Well, you know, let's dissect this and let's find out what really happened. You know, maybe they didn't really have cancer in the first place. What doctor diagnosed them anyway?" You know, all the cynicism. They might say, "Oh, isn't that wonderful? We're so glad that he got well." But then they'd start talking behind their back and say, "You know, that person said they got well of cancer. You know, they were cured, just a miracle cure like that. You know, we really got to look more at that more closely. I wonder what science would say about that." You know, and they start putting all this doubt. You know, subtle doubt. They start working the doubt factory. You know, get the doubt factory working, undermining the Dharma. And the fact is that this world is nothing but a doubt factory now. That's what people expect. So that's where their expectations are. You cannot run counter to people's expectations in this world here without severe backlash. It's not possible. And Jesus should know that. 2,000 years ago, his experience there, he ran totally counter to the expectations of the people there. Radically, radically counter to their expectations. So, you know, it's probably worse now than back then. Because we're more arrogant now. You know, with science and technology, we're so arrogant. You know, people are just, you know, they're not going to stand for this kind of stuff. So, that's my perspective. You know, I could be wrong. Jesus might have a different perspective, but that's certainly from being here in the world. That's my experience of the world. It's very frightening to even speak up at all, because again, what I have to say is how to manage your success, because it's going to shock you, and you have to w block panic. If you don't do that, I don't see any way that anyone can succeed. And so, if that's not being taught, I don't. For me, I don't see any hope whatsoever for the world. There's no way you can pull yourself up by the bootstraps and just run counter to all your expectations and then just abide in that without any trouble. There's no way you can pragmatically do that at all. It's only a theory that you could do that. Theoretically, you can. But from a pragmatic standpoint, there's no way you can do that. Because you'd have to let go of all your expectations and never go back to them instantly. Who's going to do that? Nobody is going to do that. No one, not one of us is going to do that. So, you can't just practice this practice. You can't just give out this practice outside of the context of blocking your panic and realizing about the backlash. You have to be aware of what you're doing. So I've only given out this practice after years and years of laying the context of the wow practice. You know, walking together in the wow, full stop in the wow. It's only given out in that context, and in no other context am I giving this out. Now, if you do it in that context, you won't lose your confidence. See, my problem is I didn't have this context when I came into the world. I had the attunement to truth, but I didn't have this context of how to practice properly. So that's, and nobody did. So that's why I failed. That's why I collapsed into the like an abyss of just confused expectations, really. Confusion, abyss of confusion. Didn't know what to expect and what to believe and how to shape my expectations, and just oscillating, you know, and terrible. I didn't know how to practice the wow practice. So I'm determined to focus on this for the benefit of all beings to come in future generations, to realize that you know, this is absolutely essential. It's the number one essential. And you really cannot practice effectively until you're able to do this and do it over and over again. It's like basketball. You know, you want to be a good basketball player. Guess what? You're going to be shooting a lot of hoops, okay? You don't just watch like Kevin Durant and like you never played basketball, and you watch him on the court and say, "Okay, I got it. I got it. I'm a hoopster now." Well, because I see he picks up the ball, he lifts over his head, and he throws it like that, and it goes in the basket. I get it. I'm as good as Durant now. He says, "Yeah, I get it. I'm a hoopster." Okay, I mean, there are people like that. I got it. I don't need to practice. Practice? I don't need to practice. No, I got it. I understand what he's doing. I understand. This is where I understand what he's doing. Meaning, I've got it at a superficial, conceptual level. But if you want to actually be out in that court and winning the NBA Finals by draining 35 footers, consistently, guess what? You're gonna need to practice every day like a labor of love, which is what he does. You gotta groove it. You gotta groove it and groove it and groove it under all sorts of pressure. Under all sorts of mental doubts that try to creep into you, against everyone thinking you can't do it, you're gonna miss this one. Okay, the pressure's on you. You're gonna miss this one. Too much pressure for you, But cool as a cucumber, he kept draining one after the other. After I said, "Wow, there's somebody that really practices." I didn't know he practiced, but he said, "Nobody practices harder in his life." He said, "I've just dedicated myself to being the best I can possibly be, and I work at it very diligently every day." Because I love it, he says, "I love it. I love trying to be the best at what I'm doing, or being really great at what I'm doing. I just love it." So he shows up and he does it. And so when all those doubts of the world are swirling around, everybody's screaming and losing their mind, and the idea you're gonna lose, you might lose if you don't make this, you're gonna lose, you're gonna lose if you don't make this. Somehow, he's able to make it anyway. That's not a hoopster, that's a champion. So we're not called to be hoopsters, we're called to be champions here. Okay? We're called to be champions. Anybody can think they're a hoopster. Yeah, I went to a game once, yeah. I asked the guy, "Are you a golfer?" He says, "Oh yeah, I'm definitely a golfer." Took him out golfing and it was a disaster. Hit the grass more often than he hit the ball. I said, "How many times you play golf?" He said, "Oh, a couple times." So you think you're a golfer? Yeah, okay. Well, you're not a champion golfer, let's put it that way. Okay, so let's make a delineation here. I mean, we're called to be champions here. Champions, and nothing less than champions. And to do that, you gotta to make that your goal in life, and you gotta have to love it. And you have to love practicing. I love practicing. Can't live without it. It's not easy to practice. Sometimes it's difficult to get yourself to do it, sitting down at the piano again. But after a while, you start, getting the rust off, and okay, let me play something I like. Oh, that sounds nice. Let me do a little better. Before you know it, you're in the groove of practicing. But it's always a little struggle to get in the groove of practicing. So you always have to push through some resistance, I've found. So it's never easy. It's never easy. To just accept that it's never going to be easy in terms of practicing, but you just have to do it because you love doing it. And don't look for results, just keep practicing. The results will come. The results will come. So Durant's a great champion. He's a champion because he made all the shots when all the pressure was on, when everybody else was losing their head. And make or miss, it's a make or miss thing. He made him. He made him. Consistently made him. Won the games. Won the games. That's it. He pivoted the whole thing. Amazing. That's what you call champions. That's what they're like. And champions always tell you. I've studied champions, and they really, really practice, and they practice simulating pressure. I know Tiger Woods, his dad would always simulate some sort of distraction or pressure to distract him and throw doubts in his mind. And of course, he'd get upset about it. He'd say, "Okay, you're in this tournament. This is to win the U.S. Open, and you're getting ready to hit the shot," and he'd yell something at him, like, "You idiot! Miss! Hook it!" Something, and he simulate hostility towards him, and distraction, so that he grew up getting used to dealing with all this kind of commotion, and currents of doubt trying to sweep into his mind, so that he was like so conditioned to just block it all out, Didn't pay attention to it. Just in a zone, didn't hear anything. Never, didn't make any excuses. And then when he lost that focus, then he started having problems. Started getting upset. He heard something in the crowd, like turn, stop, say, glare at them or something. It got under his skin. Started getting under his skin. But before, it's like he'd say, "What?" He said, "Tiger, were you bothered by that guy screaming at you? Missed the putt. Miss, miss, miss." He'd say, "I don't know what you're talking about. Never heard him. I don't hear anything out there. Meaning, I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem. There's nobody screaming at me. There's nobody screaming at me." You see, train yourself that way. Instead of saying, what should I say that guy is screaming at me? How do I deal with that? You say, there's nobody screaming at me. No one can ever scream at me. It's impossible. And so you don't experience it as someone screaming at you. And they say, well, he's blocking it all out. Well, it's his expectations. I'm in my own world. I'm in my world of playing golf. And in that world, nobody's screaming at me. You say that there's someone screaming at me, but that's in your world. You see, that's in your world of watching the golf. That's what that takes place. But in my world of playing golf, there's nothing bothering me at all. There's nothing. That's the attitude he had. There's nothing bothering me at all. It's impossible that anything ever bother me. Try that. Say, it's impossible that anything ever bother me. So the practice we're doing here is the practice of champions. It's the practice of champions. Anyone can be a hacker. But unless you do the practice of champions, you will remain a hacker. You'll remain that. You'll remain that. I'm not interested in playing golf as a hacker anymore. I'm interested in going out there and crushing the course. So I don't even go out. If I'm not going to go out and crush the course, I don't even play. Basically, unless the Holy Spirit asks me to. Because it's so beautiful. It's an excuse to experience tremendous beauty. Then I understand that. That's crushing the expectations of not having great beauty. Okay? Says, look, you can have great beauty, you see? Okay, at least it's possible in this way. Yeah, that's helpful. But I'm not gonna go out unless I feel I can crush the course. I've spent 40 years of being a hacker. That's enough. That's enough. And 40 years of being a hacker and on the spiritual path. That's enough. Now I'm practicing to be a champion. So you need to look at it that way. At some point, you have to decide. I've had enough of being a real hacker, a real, dilettante. It's just I'm tired of that. It doesn't really interest me anymore. We all start out as hackers and dilettantes, most of us. But ultimately, we get really bored of it, really tired of it. It doesn't satisfy us, and we've just had enough of it. And I said, no. I want to be a champion. How do I be a champion? If you don't know how, then you really have an issue, right? You feel conflicted then. But we do know how now. We do know how to be a champion on the spiritually, to awaken from dreaming, to stop dreaming, to stop pretending. Dreaming is really pretending, isn't it? Yeah, it's just mental pretending is what a dream really is. So we're practicing to simply stop pretending. Nothing can ever bother me. It's impossible that I can ever be bothered. Totally impossible. Other people can believe I'm being bothered, but that they're living in their own realm of expectations. That's what they're experiencing. I'm not experiencing that at all. In fact, it's impossible that I could be bothered in any way. They asked Sri Sri Anandamayama, have you ever been bothered by this world? Inconvenienced, bothered in the slightest way? Have you ever? She said, I've never, ever experienced that in the slightest bit. It's impossible for me. It's not possible. I can never be bothered. She would say, it's impossible for me to ever be bothered. It can't cross my mind. It can't happen. It literally can't happen. And we say, what is she talking about? It can't happen. Huh? What is she getting at? No, she's just literally stating the simple truth. And she would say that. I'm not trying to fool you. I'm not trying to speak in riddles. I'm literally just stating the simple truth. I'm just a simple child with simple truth to tell you. I literally can never be inconvenienced or bothered. It's impossible. Well, didn't you feel like deprived anyway? I can't have any needs. It's impossible for me to need anything. It's impossible for me to need anything. And she's saying, and you're the same as me. You're the same. So just practice this way. Don't try to manipulate the world so it's the world seems that way. That's totally indirect. That's like Ramana saying, you know, why try to get remove all the stones and thorns from all the pathways of the world? Why not just put on a pair of shoes? It's a lot quicker, isn't it? It's a lot easier, it's a lot quicker. So the Dharma is about putting on those pair of shoes. It's not about trying to manipulate the world so that you don't feel like you have any need. Like, I'm going to make $1 billion. Well, you still have lots of needs. First thing is, how do you hold on to the money? How to keep others from getting it? You know, how do you spend it? Yeah, there's a lot of needs that still are around the issue. But what we say is, we don't put on a pair of shoes. We don't have any needs. It's impossible that I ever have any needs at all. Not even the slightest. I can never experience even the slightest need. So it's because of the Dharma Kings, really, that I was rescued from my own turmoil of losing my confidence here in the world. Trying to express this when I was young, losing my confidence and then falling into confusion. The Dharma Kings rescued me because they did say these things. They did say these things. Ramana said them, Ananda Maima said them, Jesus said them in A Course in Miracles. And if not for them, I don't believe I would have been rescued. The culture sure didn't rescue me, okay? But the Dharma Kings did, because they did say this. They did say these things, and then I remembered and said, yeah, that sounds familiar. You're like, it's like a recollection. I know that I forgot something, and it seems like what you're saying is reminding me of what I forgot. But then I go, no, it can't be that, because the world hates that, you know. There must be some modification. I can't figure it out. So then it became all complex again, some modification. I can't modify anything. It's impossible. It's impossible. In my reality, I can't modify anything. And keep in mind that our experiencing is not a modification of what came before. It's a new, fresh, perfect, in the now creation expression of what we want to experience. It's never a modification of what came before. Never. So I can't modify anything. I can't fix anything. There's nothing to fix. I can never experience any need. I can never experience any problem. But it takes a lot of confidence to say this, right? Now, if you think you're getting sick, wait a minute. You can say, I can never, don't say I can never be sick. Say I can never have any type of health at all. Either good or bad. Jesus says, ultimately, when you got it right, you don't feel the body at all. It's not like you don't feel it in terms of like it's paralyzed. It's just like a neutral, kind of just a neutral blah. It's just that it's just calm, peaceful, neutral. Not giving you anything at all, any juice at all. You don't experience health. It's not like, I feel healthy today. People always ask you, hey, how are you doing today? Yeah, you know, everybody, you go around and says, hey, how you doing today? I say, I'm doing okay. How are you doing? I'm okay. So far, they say, so far, some. And today, they ask me, a lot of people ask me, how you doing today? I said, surprisingly, very, really good. Very well. Surprisingly well is what I said. Surprisingly well. And everybody liked that. They stopped and they said, I like that. I said, no, they never heard that before. And then someone asked me also, like, what did you do for Father's Day? I said, did you do something? They said, did you do something unusual for Father's Day? And I said, yeah, I did absolutely nothing. And that's very unusual. And then someone else at the counter looked at me and started laughing and said, that is really a unique answer. You know, I really love that. So how you doing? Surprisingly well, actually. So I said, surprisingly well. And that's how I did feel. Because I've been struggling, like we all struggle, by, you know, pushing this out, the new way out. You know, of course, it's like, you know, a very, very heavy, very intense, at times, responsibility and commitment and all of that. But I try not to see it that way. It's just, you know, I wanted to succeed. And I want to help. And so, yes, I need to do better. You know. And so it's a lot of push in my mind. And so I've kind of not been sleeping hardly at all. And my life seems to be spinning in kind of a wobbly way in every direction. And I didn't even think, how can I work today? And I don't know how to keep it together. I wasn't sure I could, but I actually did quite well. So I told people, I'm actually doing surprisingly well today. That's how I felt. Surprised. I was very surprised at how well I was functioning today, because I didn't think I could function at all today. But I functioned quite well, and others weren't functioning very well. But surprisingly well. And it's pretty much the longest day of the year right now, which is my favorite day. I wish every day would be like this. And it's the, what, the tw the 19th. So I think the 20th is 20th or 21st is the longest day of the year. And it's wonderful. I mean, I wish it would stay light until about 10 o'clock every night. What can I do? There's nothing I can do. There's not even a world to do anything in, actually. Keep in mind that the Dharma King, Sri Sri Nandamayama, said she always saw light. She said the light, the world, what she was experiencing, she actually said, they said, what are you experiencing? She said, I'm just experiencing one vast park everywhere. The only universe is just one vast, beautiful park. She didn't say she was experiencing a world, actually. She said she was experiencing just the entire universe as one, just one continuous vast park, beautiful park, and she's just strolling around through it. That's how she was experiencing. And then she said it was never dark. It was always light. It wasn't the light of the sun that she was seeing. It was a spiritual light that lit up everything. And so she never experienced darkness here. The darkness of the night. Never saw it. It was never dark. We expect to see it. We expect to see darkness, so we see it. But we could practice, say, I'm incapable of ever seeing darkness. I can't see darkness. It's impossible for me to see darkness. Now, if you're like a kid, telling your parents and and elders this stuff, they're going to think that you're insane, and you need lobotomy or something, or some sort of like work camp to like straighten you out. There's something wrong with you. Something seriously wrong with you, and that's what I faced to that discouraged me. Even with a dharmic, certainly a very dharmic dad, th this was not up his alley, Whose alley is it? Is it up? I mean, it's not up hardly anyone's alley, is it? It's hardly anyone's cup of tea to do this, even now. Although there are some that it is their cup of tea, isn't it? Yeah, there's some of you it is your cup of tea. But go easy, don't overdo it. Pace yourself and realize the shock. It's all about the shock of the wow, and being patient with that. Because you'll keep practicing till you really hit a nerve, and then once you hit a nerve, then you really got to be patient. So far, I haven't hit a really strong nerve here. For me, they've been, strong, but not a real boom, a real knockout, like what, like shock suddenly begins to arise. You can feel that when shock starts to arise. And it's not a contest to prevent it, either have it or prevent it. It's just you keep on letting the spirit flow in you. And come what may, don't focus on results. Just stay in the now of whatever arises for you. Just be determined to make as much progress as you can. I can never experience darkness at all. It's impossible. There's no such thing as darkness for me. It can't exist at all. I can never experience darkness. I can never, instead of saying, well, how can we dispel the darkness, or say, instead change your mind about the problem and say, it's impossible that I ever experience any darkness. Totally impossible. I've never experienced any darkness and never will. I've never experienced any darkness and never will. So don't ever expect you're ever going to solve any problem. And instead, practice asserting that you can never ever experience any problem. It's not possible. And therein lies the peace of God, right? We don't solve any problem. We simply accept and state the fact that there can never be any problem to solve. To try to say I can solve a problem is total arrogance. To state that there never can be any problem to solve is total humility and really just acceptance of reality as it is, instead of trying to change it. So, I may be getting my mojo back, but it's taken me my entire life, really, 48 years to get my mojo back. And during that time, I was as about as low as you can go. So it the it's very it can be very tough here. Trying to pioneer this was very tough, to say the least. I don't want to do it again. So let's get the momentum going. I say to Jesus, hey, don't expect me to do this again. Once is enough. Because you trying to assert this when you're young in a non-dharmic culture, just the backlash is absolutely, insane. They're convinced that you're insane. Dangerously insane, actually. And blasphemous, to say the least. But at least I didn't get that too much of that. Although I did try this with some fundamental religious people, and they tried to kill me. They said, "You repent from this, or we're going to kill you." So I said, "Wow, you got to be careful who you talk with here," because for them it was utterly blasphemous what I was saying. They were certain that Jesus is the one who came to fix all their problems and punish all the wicked and destroy the wicked for them, those who didn't fit their expectations, that he would cast them into eternal hellfire, and all this traditional fear-based religion. Not all religion has been fear-based. Some wallow in that more than others, right? So you mean, he says, yeah, I mean, we're definitely going to die, and we deserve to die, but because Jesus died, for us, and they have their formulas, but they don't want to hear what we're saying here, that there's no problem, we can't have any problems. They say, well, then what role does Jesus have, you see? It sounds blasphemous to them. Well, Jesus' role is to remind us that we can't have any problems. That's his role. So he pretended to be a human being because we wouldn't listen to him otherwise. And they said, Jesus, if you knew the problems that we're having, you would never say that we can't have problems. Believe me. And Jesus said, okay, really? And so he went and healed everyone instantly, 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 instantly. And they said, yeah, but you still haven't tasted the worst of the problems here. Let's see you be crucified and tell us that you don't have any problem, that you can't ever have problems. Problems, no, it's impossible to ever have problems. So Jesus said, okay, you got it. So they watched him supposedly being crucified, and later there he is, bingo, he's fresh as a daisy. He said, no, I was just pretending to be crucified to show you it's all pretense. You can't really have any problems. I never had a problem of being crucified or dying. And neither do you. So that really ran counter to their expectations and sent shockwaves throughout the culture, and is still sending shockwaves throughout the culture. But it's kind of stalled out, and people are just saying, no, he did suffer, he did die, he was buried, he really actually did suffer problems, but through some mystery that we can't understand, we can both have problems and not have them. Chalcedonian Creed. Yeah, Jesus is both human and divine. Jesus both had problems and did not have problems. No, the only issue Jesus had is how to get through to everyone that there are no problems. Because he could not have done what he did unless he came into this world knowing very well that it's impossible for us to have problems. Problems can't exist at all. How could he go about healing, healing, healing like that, instantly like that, and saying we did? Of course, he had to come in with that determination to accept truth. Or knowing it perfectly and just pretending, consciously pretending, which is what Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma did, is she was fully aware that she was just pretending to be a human. She said she never lost complete, total awareness of this. Even said before she was born, as she was being born, after she was born, she has exactly the same awareness and consciousness. Knew 100% she was merely playing a game, pretending here, so that we, she could, we, she could give us the truth, and that we could hear it coming from a body, thinking, well, that must be true. If it's coming from someone in this world, it tends to have more weight to it. So Jesus, they said, well, Jesus, you know, you come into the world and experience our misery, and you're going to sing a different tune, like we guarantee you. And he says, well, let's see how it goes. So